What time is it? This is a continuation of racial reconciliation, end time prophecy, and the body of Christ. And today I want to go further into what time is it? What time are we living in right now? What prophetic end time space are we in? We all know that only God knows when he's going to return. And only God knows the time and the season. But from biblical perspective, the book of Daniel is what most of this presentation is going to be about. And it will also be about coming through history, dealing with Ham, Shem, and Japheth. And Japheth are the nations that are empowered. This is that end time Gentile domain that will usher in the return of Christ. We all know that it started in the garden, and everyone started in the garden. Every race on the face of the earth had their roots in Adam and Eve, mitochondria even in their DNA. Science has proven that the scriptures are plain, that out of one couple came all nations. And so if you set that on the landscape as we go through this, just keep in your mind that we all started out from the same root. The tree grew and took on different branches, but the root is the same. Mitochondrial Eve, in a special edition of U.S. News, July 2009, Mysteries of Science, a study of genetics using this new technology discovered that Adam's Y chromosome is carried by all men alive. So same root, I mean, it has continued generation to generation, has not changed. The Y chromosome has been passed down from generation to generation, father to son, essentially unchanged. So it doesn't matter about the outward look of us. We have the same root. The same is true of the mitochondrial DNA because all are copies of the same original. The mitochondrial DNA belonging to a single woman, Eve. In other words, DNA evidence corroborates the idea that all humans descend from just one couple, Adam and Eve, according to Genesis and what the scripture already declares. And here's a depiction of Adam and Eve through the ancient churches in Ethiopia, which were quite ancient. They were dug underground. And you can see Adam and Eve with afros, if you will, but that tan and brown skin covering themselves after the fall. Archaeological and scientific racism and even biblical racism is why we are where we are today, even in this country in 2021, with the rise of hatred, the rise of anti-Semitism, the rise of anti-Asians, the rise of anti-Black. It's been here all along. It's just being more publicized. This Black on Black, this hatred, nationalism, supremacy, neo-Nazis, all of it, they are emboldened now. And you know, that's sort of like the dream I had in 2012, prophetic dream that said that the end of this whole thing was going to be racism. Not just what the world does, but what is happening in the body of Christ. That we can promote division, that we can sin without partiality. Scripturally, Christ said, his body is not divided. In fact, his death brought together the Jew and the Gentiles. Okay, that the Jew and the Gentiles were any other non-Jewish nation. There were the Gentiles, which was every other race from Ham, Shem, and Japheth. And then there was the Jews that God called out and chose. That was it. God brought the two together. In Ephesians, he says, He broke down the wall of hostility and he made them one. And Christ is no respect of persons. In fact, he says he neither sees male nor female, slave nor free, rich nor poor. He doesn't see any of that. Archaeology or scientific racism takes evidence that something or someone existed and either ignores what it sees or dismisses it and interprets or reinterprets it through prejudiced lens. For a long time, most of the archaeology and science was interpreted by Europeans, Egyptologists, whose views were already tainted with racism. The hieroglyphs speaks for themselves. They left evidence of what they looked like in their statues and on the walls of their tombs and their temples and their palaces. This is Prince Rehoptep and Prince Nefertiti. And I think it's quite, it is painted to color. It is very authentic, and it is ancient, 4,600 years old. And these people who sit before us side by side, colored to their life, fresh and glowing as the clay. This is the day that they were in the artist's sense. And so from a genetic perspective, all humans are Africans, either residing in Africa or in recent accent. We all come from the same root. It's the same root, people. It's the same root. And these are Ham had more nations and tribes, and he had 104. So there's lots of brown and black people scattered throughout the world. They are out there. And there were mixed marriages. So it wasn't just one race. It was Ham and Shem, even when they were in Canaan and they were supposed to be destroying the Canaanites because that was the land God had promised. They were intermarrying with the Canaanite women. Even you see in the genealogies of the kings, of David, of Moses, Abraham, okay, Hagar was an Egyptian. And so since there were no black, or since there were no white people in this biblical setting of Ham and Japheth, Africa and Arabia, I won't even mention them because they didn't show up until before Christ's time, before Christ came and so was born. And so as we talk about the Old Testament, just know they were all brown and black people. That's just the way it was. Just even here with some of the hieroglyphs that you see, these are Egyptians. You see the differences in their skin colors. And this is a very, it talks about DNA. These are, you know, these are Jews right here. These are Shem's son. They have the tassels on their clothes, which was how Hebrews dressed, the Jews dressed. These are the Ethiopians, the Nubians. These are the Egyptians and some more Jews. And these are, they call them, I believe they were up in the Canaanite area. I think they were a mix of Syrians and what became Assyrians. And the DNA is of the modern Egyptian is quite diverse as it carries traces from Southwest Asia and the Persian Gulf at 17%, Jewish diaspora at 4%, Eastern Africa at 3%. There are all kinds of ancestries there now. But in the beginning, before all the intertwining and the intermarriage, that's what you had. And a number of scholars believe the ancient Egyptian culture was directly influenced by other cultures, and I do believe it, but what it was not white culture. Here's another hieroglyph from a tomb, and you can see the differences. The people coming into Egypt, the different races, the Egyptians, all the brown and black people. Here's another from Ramesses' tomb, which I find very colorful, and I love the way they dress because, you know, they all had this. When you think about culture and ethnicities, think about this. It's a group of people, nations, tribe, and tongues. It's also where the nation, where they're geographically, how they all dress, how they all spoke, what they ate. I like the fact, and I use it because it's real. Ethnicity had nothing to do with the body of Christ. And it didn't become an issue until race was brought into the picture. But these this is a multi-diverse picture of the world in ancient biblical times before we modernized. Again, this is East Africa, the beginning of the human race. So Adamic roots of mankind, like I said, we all come from the same roots. There was a flood for 1600 years. Mankind existed until they grieved God. He was sick of them because they were sinning. They disobeyed him. They had a choice and they chose to disobey. And when they had made a decision, they made the wrong choice, and it's been rolling down since Adam and Eve, and we all have continued to make wrong choices. But anyway, after the flood, Noah, Ham, Shem, Japheth, when the waters receded, they migrated to the plains of Shinar and built the tower in modern-day Iraq. They were dispersed. Ham went one way, Shem was placed in his land, and Japheth in his. And so this is a timeline that I did, and it brings you to when the flood ended with Adam and Eve, and then the flood, the earth was divided. And actually, the earth was divided after 101 years after the flood, because there was so much rain, so much water that had to cover the earth during the flood. God had it receded, and therefore tectonic plates were moved. Actual continents were split. The Red Sea was not there in the beginning of time. There were no seas on the land, but the land, because Pangaea, God put the seas on the side, and one, he raised up the earth so the earth could be the main thing. And so, and then they built in 2100, after they were scattered at the Tower of Babel, where they, which is in present Iraq, they were building a tower. And then, and right around that time in 2000, the ancient Sumerian language ended. It became isolated. There was only one language back then. Guess what? At the tower, they were all speaking the same language, okay? When God scattered them, that language stopped. There was no more Sumerian spoken. And they called that a language isolate. And then in 2001, Abraham's birth, and Terah left Ur for Canaan, but he never got there. He stopped in Haran, where he died. And Abraham leaves Haran when he was 75 years old and makes his way to his history in Egypt, Canaan, with a few different ways. So Japheth's descendants were scattered. These are what we call white people, Caucasians, Europeans. Japheth's descendants were scattered to the north and the Isles. Thus, Caucasians developed, giving rise to what we call Europe today. And these all happened at the same time, because it was at the tower. And Ham's descendants were returned to the place which they originally, they all race inhabited in Africa and Egypt. And Shem's sons were scattered, giving rise to the Semitic Asian races. And Abraham was born, giving rise to the Israelites. So Noah lived 350 years after the flood, okay? And the patriarch Cush changed, was the first empire builder, the first leader of humanity after the flood. And God changed their languages, rewiring their brains and memories. God changed their DNA, that 0.12% that has to do with our skin tone, our hair, and eyes only. God changed the places where they would develop. That was a reset. It was a reset. And historically, in all the writings, the black people, which they call Ethiopians, because the Ethiopians were dark skinned, but the Ethiopians represent all the races during Adam and Eve's. Everybody was black or brown. And so they called them Ethiopian, but they were just humanity, the mass of humanity, okay? It followed as it did. And so that is part of the beginning. But I need to talk about now jumping toward history to the beginning. We had Ham, we had Jacob, we had Shem. So Daniel's end time prophecy, we had the Egyptians, we had the Semites and David, the Jewish history, the temples, the travels, the kings, Jerusalem falls to Babylon, and that's where we will begin, because that is where Daniel's prophecy makes a lot of sense. Okay. The last dominion of man. God gave a prophecy when Ham uncovered his father's nakedness. He said, when Noah woke from his wine and found out what his youngest son had done to him, he said, cursed be Canaan. Only Canaan was cursed, not Ham, because God had already blessed Ham. Now, his other sons, Cush, Mizraim, and Put, this had nothing to do with skin tones because they were still homogenous and brown. The fact that Japheth lost pigmentation and genetic footprint was reset after God scattered them to the northern climes with less sun caused what we see today in the paleness and absence of color of Japheth's descendants. Then the curse was that Canaanites will be the lowest of slaves, will he be to his brothers. And people misinterpreted this scripture as that all black people, and the first, when they explored Africa, they declared that all black people, all Africans were cursed. That was a lie. The curse had already taken place to the Canaanites. It had nothing to do with the rest of Mizraim or Put or Cush's descendants or Ham's descendants. It was just his grandson, Canaan. And praise to the Lord, the God of Shem. May Canaan be the slaves of Shem. May God extend Japheth's territory, and may Japheth live in the tents of Shem, and may Canaan be the slaves of Japheth. Well, we have seen that. We have seen that. But the curse was Canaan. Keep that in mind. It was not all Africans, only the Canaanites. And so Nebuchadnezzar had a dream. This is after Babylon had ramshacked the temple that Solomon had built. God had warned the Jews over and over again to repent and return to him, and they chose not to. And so Nebuchadnezzar had a dream in Daniel 2:31-45. He said, Your Majesty, and there before you stood a large statue, an enormous, dazzling statue, awesome in appearance. The head of the statue was made of pure gold, its chest and arms of silver, its belly and thighs of bronze, its legs of iron, its feet partly of iron and partly of baked clay. Keep that partly of iron and partly of baked clay in mind. So in 606, the Babylonian Empire existed, okay? From 605 to 539 BC, the first was like a lion but had eagle wings. I continued watching until its wings were torn off. It was lifted up from the ground, set on its feet like a man and given a human mind. And that's what exactly happened to King Nebuchadnezzar, because God had granted him the world. He ruled the world. But pride, arrogance, he forgot who was in charge. He thought he was large and in charge, but no, he wasn't. And so he declared himself God, basically forgetting God, and God humbled him. For 7 years, he ate grass outdoors on his all fours for 7 years until he came to his senses and recognized that it's God who rules in the kingdom of man. And so God reduced him, put him on all fours for 7 years outdoors. He lost his mind until he acknowledged God. Okay, he was given extensive authority and King Nebuchadnezzar destroyed the temple in 586 BC, the one that Solomon had built. It was destroyed. The people were taken captive, and Daniel actually was one of those young men that were taken captive from Jerusalem to Babylon. And after King Nebuchadnezzar's time period ended, suddenly another beast appeared, a second one that looked like a bear. It was raised up on one side with three ribs in its mouth between its teeth. It was told, get up, gorge yourself on flesh. This was Darius the Great, the Medo Persian Empire, 539 to 330 BC. Darius allowed the Jews to return and to rebuild the temple. And then after the Medo-Persian, these are governments now. So we've had the Babylonian government and empire ended, okay? Then we have the Medo-Persian empire government, it has ended. And now we come into a whole different reign. And to me, this is the beginning of the reign of Japheth's sons. The Bible said they would expand. And that meant they would just be all over the earth. And that's exactly what happened. It started with Alexander the Great in 323 to 146 BC. Alexander died early. He took a whole swath, all the Middle Eastern lands that you see. He came down and he took over. And while I was watching, another beast appeared. It was like a leopard with four wings of a bird on its back. It had four heads and was given authority to rule. And so the leopards with the wings represent the speed of conquest. You know, it was fast for Alexander the Great. And when Alexander died, his four generals took over. Alexander believed in Hellenization. They took over the Jews, Jerusalem. They took over East. They took over all of what we see as the ancient Middle East. And then came the Roman Empire, 168 BC to 476. And while I was watching in the night, visions of four beasts appeared, frightening and dreadful and incredibly strong, with large iron teeth. It devoured and crushed, and it trampled with its feet whatever was left. It was different from all the beasts before it, and it had 10 horns. Now, I don't get into trying to identify the 10 horns. I mean, there are lots of the 10 nations that were there, the 10 kings, the 10 nations. Even to me, I look at World War I, World War II. What were the 10 nations that were in charge? But while I was considering the horns, suddenly another horn, a little one, came up among them. And three of the first horns were uprooted before it. And there were eyes in this horn like a man's, and it had a mouth that spoke arrogantly. Well, this could be just about, you could sort of use this to point to a lot of different things, and I'm going to refrain from that. There were 10 nations in charge with World War I, with the world wars in Europe. There were the same with the Roman Empire and people in the feet of clay. So, but the Roman Empire ruled, it took over, and it is still ruling, okay? He said the fourth beast will appear on earth. It will be different from all the other kingdoms, and it will devour the whole earth, trampling it down and crushing it. And Rome was divided. It was a divided kingdom, Western Roman Empire and then the Eastern Roman Empire. Constantinople took over. You had the Roman, the Catholicism, Augusta. And in 1453, the Byzantine Constantinople fell to the Ottoman Turks in 1453. And this is, to me, when prophetic word really began to unfold. It was epic, this whole 1415, right in this area, centuries, the Renaissance, scientific revolution, the exploration of America, and it brought us to this time that we just recently came to. But the evidence, the influence of the Roman Empire on Western civilization was profound, and its lasting contribution, it's still here. So we had the Roman Empire, it fell in 1453, but it resurrected itself. Western Europeans' historical events include the Renaissance, the Age of Discovery, Protestant Reformation, Martin Luther, and the Counter-Reformation of the Catholic Church, the Age of Enlightenment, the French Revolution, and the Industrial Revolution. They all collided in that one particular season. The prophetic word that God would enlarge Japheth in the Pentateuch and Haftorah, the comment states that Japheth, the progenitor of the Indo-European or Aryan peoples, receives the blessing of worldly prosperity and widespread dominion. And this is the last kingdom of the Gentiles. So keep in mind, we've had Ham and Shem with Babylon, with the Medo-Persian, the first two. And before them, we had Egypt, Israel, and the Assyrian kingdoms, which were still part of the brown and the black and the Shem and Ham's descendants. And now we are at Japheth. And if you can follow at different times, Japheth's descendants, whether it was Gomer and the British Isles that came down, this was the beginning with Alexander the Great of the world domination and widespread dominion of Japheth's son, as prophesied in Genesis 9:27. And the trampling of the people of clay, to me, it started at the same time, because up until this point, before Africa was colonized and slaves were kidnapped and sold, which is a sin according to scripture, it is, you can see how during the during that whole 12th through 16th, 17th, 18th centuries, that everything began to change, okay? The end time kingdom, the feet of iron and clay, and that clay is important to me because it's baked to fire clay. That's brown people, okay? We came from the clay, brown people. But Japheth began Hellenizing all the nations, including Jerusalem and Israel, changing their language, changing their customs, changing their DNA, changing them. So widespread. So when you think about Japheth in the temps of Shem, just look at the colonization. Just look at how many times they took over. Just look at it, and you'll see that. So the baked clay to me were all of the previous descendants of the governments of Shem and Ham. And the territories by the European powers, just look at this map, just keep an eye on it, and you'll see all of the places that they took over, and you see the dates, okay? Here's the date. See that? This is the expansion of Japheth's son. They took over. And this map goes up. See this? Everything was colonized or collected. Everything. And then you see it going back. 1959, 1948, the Jews came into their homeland again. 1974, it backs off. But they took over everything. The whole world. This is the expansion. And this is the time that we're in right now. So 1600, and you come down here to 2021. Jesus is like, yeah, he's got that rock in his hands that he's going to throw and destroy all the kingdoms, all of them. And he's going to establish his government. And you see the imperialism. European, they settled in India, 1498 to 1739. Okay, their expansion in Portugal, Spain, they overtook all the brown people. Okay, even here, Africa, all the places, they expanded. It was a done deal. That's right. South America, North America, and so here we are right now. And where are we? We are at the end times. We are at this place where God is waiting to return. What time is it? With all the racial unrest we have, with all the rising up of whites, with all of the hatred and the racism in the church, it's about time for his return.